So, on to our first workshop of the Congress. Science or philosophy, which is the best model for free inquiry? So thank you so much for coming along. I know there's lots of competing sessions, but I will maintain the ones that I'm chairing are going to be the best ones. So time was when philosophy was the love of wisdom and the pursuit of knowledge. And Aristotle was not alone in the ancient world in combining what we now see as science with analytical knowledge and moral philosophy. But for Newton, the pursuit of knowledge stretched beyond optics and mechanics into alchemy. While for Descartes, the existence of anything but one's own thinking mind depended on belief in God. And for Berkeley, nothing existed when it was not observed. History abounds both in erroneous scientific theories and in philosophical systems liable to collapse like a house of cards. So we need to know how to sort the wheat from the chaff. What are the comparative merits of science and philosophy in this task? Whose claims are true, and perhaps also whose opinions are worth listening to? Can either operate reliably without the other? Now, to tackle these very thorny issues, we have two excellent speakers. The first being Peter Atkins, who is a former professor of chemistry at the University of Oxford, who is back in his old stomping ground here, who researched the application of quantum mechanics to chemical problems and theoretical aspects of magnetic resonance. After this, he moved into writing books and has now published over 70 both major chemistry textbooks and also popular science books. He's written on issues of humanism, atheism, and the incompatibility of science and religion, and has appeared in many television programs on the subject. I'll warn you in advance that Peter doesn't pull any punches when it comes to the subject of religion, but I'll leave that to him. Our second speaker is Stephen Law. Stephen is an English philosopher and member of the BHA's Humanist Philosophers Group. And he's been a provost of the Centre for Inquiry UK since 2008, which is a division of the BHA. He's editor of the philosophical think journal Think, published for general readership by the Royal Institute of Philosophy. So, without further ado, I will first introduce to you Peter Atkins.
I thought Stephen was going to go first, so I was just going to attack what he said. So I've been set up quite clearly. I do apologise. I also apologise for the title. I thought it should be The Comparative Better, not Best. But anyway, that's the bureaucracy out of the way. Yes, philosophy is good for free inquiry, provided you emphasise the free. That is, so long as you're not constrained by evidence, and that you are free to explore wherever your thoughts take you. This, of course, comes out in the worst possible way when philosophy becomes theology, where inventions are made which are then pursued down the ages. And I think that's a clear example of an example where free inquiry is iniquitous. That's about all I've got to say, I think.
But, the rest of my case.
an example, I suppose, of where free inquiry, loosely and interpreted, I think, in a way that maybe Stephen is likely to interpret it, is inappropriate without appealing to evidence, is exemplified by the Greek philosophers, to whom we should show a great deal of pleasure and honour, because they did start humanity thinking. And I think that was rather wonderful. But of course, that's all they did. And people like Aristotle sat around on marble steps thinking about what the world was probably like, should be like, is like, without appealing to any evidence whatsoever. Not quite true in biology, of course, where he was rather more carefully attuned to evidence, but certainly in physics. And such was his grip on humanity's inclination to understand that his errors persisted for millennia. And I think that's an example of where free inquiry without evidence can be extremely damaging. The joy of science, and it is a joy of science, is that mankind has stumbled on the most obvious way of thinking about the nature of the world, which is to see what is going on, make notes, compare notes, and perhaps most important of all, to embed the notes and observations in a reticulation of phenomena, a reticulation, a network of concepts and understanding. No part of science is an island, and I think we should remember that. Discoverers in one part of science, discoveries that almost invariably are made on the basis of observation edging us further forward, never clash with observations made elsewhere in science. One set of observations, let us say in cosmology, informs the observations in, let us say, particle physics, the two extremes, if you like, of magnitude. And it's quite extraordinary how science, and more generally, how understanding of the nature of the world edges forward on the basis of relating observation to this reticulation of existing concepts. You can see an effect of that in the way that philosophy has slowly lost any area in which it used to be dominant. Of course, it used to be dominant in theology, but we all know that theology is nonsense, and most philosophers accept that it's nonsense unless they're paid by one church or the other. And that serious philosophers, that is, secular philosophers, know that theology has really been taken away from their domain. Science in general, the objects of scientific inquiry, which used once to be part of the domain of philosophy, natural philosophy of course, they've lost out. No scientist these days listens to what philosophers have to say. My classification of philosophers and scientists is that philosophers are almost invariably pessimists, whereas scientists are almost invariably optimists. And that philosophers say, you cannot tread there, you will never understand. Scientists largely ignoring these sheet anchors of philosophy, goes into the laboratory, does some work, and then shows to the philosopher what they thought could never be done. And we know that there are big open questions, extraordinarily difficult questions, which philosophers think that, and indeed many assert, it will never be within our capability of resolving, such as the origin of the universe, such as the nature of consciousness. Don't listen to them. The evidence is supportive of the optimism that that pervades the attitudes of scientists. We are edging towards understanding, and there is no reason to suppose, other than pessimism, that we will not get there. And so the domains of inquiry and philosophy are falling away because they do not have the key to truth. The key to truth is evidence. And it's your turn to...
Is that right? Okay, well, I thought what I would do is just, as a philosopher, explain what I think philosophy is and why I think it's an important activity. Let me begin by tipping my hat, as philosophers often do, to science. I mean, it's worth saying very clearly at the outset that if you want to find out about how things stand out there in the world, then the application of the scientific method is one of the very best methods available in terms of discovering how things stand. I rather doubt that you're going to discover anything about how things stand out there in reality by sitting in your armchair with your eyes closed, having a good old think about it. And that is Peter's concern, and he's right, of course, that's true. So why don't I just then sort of roll over and concede that philosophy is a waste of time then? Well, because that's just a misunderstanding of what philosophy is, that's why. So let me just explain what I think philosophy is. Science addresses many questions, but there appear to be questions that are questions that are beyond the remit of science, of the empirical sciences, to answer. And, you know, you can think of your own examples, but classic examples would be, for example, why is there anything at all? Why is there something rather than nothing? That's a famous philosophical conundrum. Can science answer that fundamental question? Well, of course, scientists can point to the Big Bang. They can say we've discovered the Big Bang happened 13 or 14 billion years ago. But of course, that really postpones the question, doesn't it? The mystery of why there's something rather than nothing, because well, now we want to know, well, why did the Big Bang happen rather than not? Perhaps other theories will develop. Perhaps there'll be a theory of quantum vacuums in which the Big Bang happens as a spontaneous event, given the pre-existing quantum conditions. Perhaps that would explain it, but then we just want an explanation for those pre-existing quantum conditions, don't we? Scientific explanations work like this. They point to laws or causes that account for phenomena and explain the phenomena in that kind of way. If you want a scientific explanation of why the water in your pipes froze last Thursday, the scientist will say, it is a law of nature that water freezes below 0 degrees centigrade. The temperature fell below 0 degrees centigrade last Tuesday. Hence, the water froze in your pipes last Tuesday. That is a scientific explanation, perfectly good one. But you can see that if that's how scientific explanation works, when it comes to the most fundamental laws and most fundamental causes, they will not be explicable by science. They will either just have to accept them as a brute fact, or we will have to look for some other kind of explanation for them. And it's those kind of questions, then, that philosophers are particularly interested in. Theologians too, of course, they'll be reaching for God at that point. I'm not amongst them, I'm a philosopher. It seems to me that the project of philosophy is to attempt to answer these questions as best we can by applying reason. That's not to say that we will necessarily succeed, but we might be able to work out that certain answers are no good, and it seems to me that we can figure out pretty quickly that the theological ones are no good, and that, it seems to me, would be some philosophical progress. Another area in which it seems to me that science quickly runs out of steam is morality. David Hume famously invoked the is-ought gap. Science discovers what is the case. It discovers that there is blood and that there is screaming and so on. There is pain, there is suffering. But in an argument, premises that concern what is the case always fail logically to support conclusions about what one ought or ought not to do. And yet morality is concerned with what one ought or ought not to do. Therefore, science cannot justify moral positions or moral conclusions, at least not the most fundamental positions that we take. Of course, science has a role within moral debate, because very often the conclusions we draw are a combination, draw on premises that are both moral premises and empirical premises. So, for example, I might believe that women ought not to have the vote. I don't believe that, by the way. But let's suppose, for the sake of argument, I believe women ought not to have the vote. Why do I believe that? Well, because I believe that women are dim, and dim people ought not to have the vote. Now, you can see what I've done there. I've got two premises, that dim people ought not to be able to vote. The other premise is that women are dim. That premise is empirically falsifiable, and indeed empirically falsified, and scientists can establish that, and so they can establish that my conclusion doesn't follow. So it's not that science is irrelevant when it comes to moral argument. It is relevant, but science cannot, it seems, justify our most fundamental moral beliefs because of this famous is-ought gap. So, I am not signing up to scientism, which is the view that science can answer every legitimate question. It seems to me that these are perfectly good and legitimate questions, and it seems to me that in some cases it is in principle impossible for science to answer those questions. Those are the questions that philosophers and also theologians tend to focus on. Let me then talk about how we might approach these kind of puzzles. What method might we apply? Well, it seems to me that philosophers are essentially conceptual engineers, okay? We work with concepts, and many puzzles are conceptual puzzles, and I'm going to give you one or two examples of simple conceptual puzzles. So, for example, the mirror puzzle. You look into a mirror every day and you don't think twice about it, but now think about this. Why do mirrors reverse left to right but not top to bottom? Why is that? It's a really hard puzzle. You'll find Plato thinking about that puzzle and failing to solve it, right? Can science solve that puzzle? The answer is no, it can't, because it doesn't matter how much scientific data you get in or how many scientific theories you develop about how light bounces off the surface of the mirror. The fact is that the light bounces off the surface of the mirror in exactly the same way, whether it's on this axis or in that axis. It makes no difference whatsoever. You can have as many scientific discoveries and as much scientific theorizing as you like. You will never solve that puzzle until you start thinking conceptually. It's a conceptual puzzle. If you want to solve that puzzle, you can do it from the comfort of your armchair. I'm not going to do it for you now. But you can do it from the comfort of your armchair. It's essentially something you can figure out with your eyes closed just by having a think about it. That's philosophy. That's what philosophy is. There are puzzles that are purely conceptual in nature that you need conceptual methods to solve. Again, here's another simple example. Suppose I were to say that might your brother's mother's sister be your nephew's father's wife? Do you need to employ a scientist to answer that question? No. Do you need to engage in any kind of empirical inquiry? No. You can figure out the answer just by having a good old think about it from the comfort of your armchair. There are plenty of puzzles that are essentially conceptual puzzles that are not scientific puzzles, that do not require the application of the scientific method in order for us to solve them. Those are the puzzles that we're focusing on. Another one, going all the way back to ancient Greece, is can you jump in the same river twice? Heraclitus pondered that one. You might think, well, if I jump in and then I get out and then I jump in again, then the water's moved a bit and the fish have pooed in the water and it's changed in various ways, so it's not the same river. And if it's not the same river, then the number of rivers, right, is two, not one. But that sounds wrong, doesn't it? Here's another reason why you can't jump in the same river twice. It won't be you that jumps in the second time, because you would have changed in the interim. No matter how short a period of time has elapsed, there will change would have taken place, so it won't be the same person, therefore the number of people is two. In other words, nothing ever changes. It just disappears and gets replaced by another thing that's very slightly different to it. Now that's an extraordinarily silly and absurd metaphysical conclusion generated by an argument that's got something wrong with it, right? How do you figure out what's wrong with the argument by doing empirical science? No, right? The way you figure out what's wrong with the argument is you sit in your armchair with your eyes closed and you start making conceptual distinctions, in this case, between different kinds of sameness or identity. That argument just trades on an ambiguity between two different ways of using the expression the same. And once you've spotted that, you go, well, of course, right? But until you've spotted it, you might be tempted to draw some silly metaphysical conclusions. Again, philosophical progress. So that's what philosophers do, it seems to me. It seems to me that many of these are fairly trivial examples, but the mind-body problem is, in essence, a philosophical puzzle. It's a conceptual puzzle. Scientists may discover all sorts of facts about minds and brains and what goes on in one being correlated with something going on in the other and so on, but is the mind the brain or not? What's the connection between the two? There appears to be a philosophical puzzle there, because on the one hand it looks like minds have to be brains, or at least physical, in order to have any physical effects. On the other hand, it seems they can't possibly be, because there seems to be some kind of conceptual obstacle to identifying minds with brains. I won't go into the details, but there appears to be such a conceptual obstacle. If you, as a scientist, want to solve that puzzle and show that minds are brains, you have to do conceptual engineering. You're going to have to employ a philosopher, because it's a philosophical, conceptual puzzle, not a scientific puzzle. No matter how much science you do, you're never going to solve the conceptual puzzle that is the mind-body problem. So it seems to me that, again, it's a properly philosophical puzzle. So it seems to me that philosophy is different to science, but that's not to say that philosophy is a waste of time. It's essentially conceptual engineering. It's important to have philosophers around to be asking the right kind of questions. Very often, it doesn't even occur to the scientist to ask a philosophical question. It seems to me it's important to have philosophers around in the same way it's important to have trained magicians around when scientists are investigating Uri Geller, right? Because when they investigate Uri Geller, they get tricked and they get fooled and they miss what any trained magician is going to spot in a minute, right? You need a different skill set when you're dealing with that kind of problem and that kind of claim, and scientists don't have that skill set, okay? Philosophy is similar in that it deals with certain kinds of problems, it employs certain kind of methods. You tend to find the same kind of problems cropping up again and again and again, and so you, as a philosopher, you tend to get very good at dealing with those problems. That's what we do. Okay? It's not science, it doesn't pretend to be science, but it is nevertheless, it seems to me, very important. I'll stop there.
This discussion is the fact that there are two genuinely opposing views. So what I'm going to do before I open up any questions from the floor is I'm going to give each speaker a 5-minute comeback. Within, less than 5 minutes.
What a litany of pessimism that was. What a litany. It illustrated the point that I was making. Either the philosophers spend a lot of time saying you'll never be able to do something, or they spend their time on problems that have no relevance at all to the world. And you saw examples of that from Stephen's talk just now. Will scientists ever be able to talk about the origin of the world from absolutely nothing? Who knows? They are currently trying. And it's no point in saying, you will not ever do it. Let the scientists get on with the job of doing it. Will the scientists never be able to talk about the roots of morality? Of course they can talk about the roots of morality. What they have to do is to take the anthropological evidence, they have to take the ethological evidence, they have to take the evolutionary evidence, and they have to think about the way that we humans can think about the consequences of our actions. So the scientists are working on that other domain of philosophy, which philosophers are desperately trying to defend for themselves. They will fail. Scientists will expose the answers to these questions, and the philosophers will be left in a yet smaller at the corner of the intellectual universe that they're currently painting themselves into. All the other problems about concepts, and that philosophers spend their time on conceptual problems, I mean, that's empty. It's all about linguistics. And people about applying particular words to particular things. It's a complete waste of time. We all know what a river is. And if we said that, did I jump into the River Thames twice, the answer would be perfectly clear. And I don't think there is any conceptualizing except to keep philosophers in the jobs that they're trying to in the face of all the evidence that they're trying to keep. So, although I think philosophers are wonderful people, it's certainly the case that almost all of them have wasted their time through the centuries. And currently, happily, they're migrating to that small intellectual corner of the universe where it doesn't matter what they say, because no one need listen to them anymore. Stephen.
Well, where to begin? It's a complete waste of time because it's conceptual. No, you can establish really important things by just doing a bit of armchair theorising. I mean, draw really big, important conclusions. So, for example, you can probably establish from the comfort of your armchair that there is no God, and conclusions don't really come much bigger than that, it seems to me. Yes, you can. I've done it. I'll explain it to you later, really. It's also worth remembering that scientists themselves acknowledge the importance of conceptual work. So, for example, there is the famous thought experiment run by Galileo, who was a critic of the Aristotelian view, right, that had the consequence that a large metal ball and a small metal ball, differing masses, would fall at different speeds depending on the mass. Okay, that was a consequence of the Aristotelian theory. And Galileo is supposed to have climbed the Tower of Pisa and thrown these two balls off to see what would happen, but actually he probably didn't do that. And what he certainly did do was he ran a thought experiment. He said, imagine, a bit of conceptual work now, imagine the two balls are chained together, right? Now, if Aristotle's theory is true, how are they going to fall? Are they going to fall faster or slower or at the same speed? You just combine their mass, so they must fall faster. However, the small ball being chained to the big ball, it previously fell slower than the big ball, it will be acting as a brake on the big ball, therefore the two balls must fall slower. So we've just derived a logical contradiction from Aristotle's theory of motion, which shows that Aristotle's theory of motion is false. So we've just shown, we don't know what's actually going to happen when you throw the balls off the top of the Tower of Pisa. We'd have to do some science to establish that, but you know in advance that that particular scientific theory is false, and we've established that by doing conceptual engineering. Okay, so even scientists do it, see the value of it. This is all trivial and important, and also points to the fact that it's very often moral questions that we're interested in. It seems to me that these are some of the most important questions that there are. I've already explained why, if Hume is correct, you can never justify moral conclusions by reference to premises that concern what is the case. And those are the only premises that science is going to be able to deliver. Peter pointed to anthropology and ethnography and so on, various other scientific disciplines, which he supposes might ultimately answer the question about the origin of morality, which would be very interesting and well worthwhile, but completely irrelevant because it wasn't the question that I raised, which is why are certain positions right or wrong, not why do we think certain positions are right or wrong. It may be a product of our evolutionary heritage that we think certain things are right and other things are wrong. That doesn't make them right or wrong. If you want to justify them as moral positions, you're going to need a different kind of argument, not the argument that Peter offered. I mean, what's striking is that Peter can't even see the difference between those two questions. He doesn't even get it, right? And that is worrying.
Questions from the floor. Please wait for the mics to come to you. Please try and keep the questions short so we can get through as many people as possible. So can we begin with this lady over here, please?
Well, I'm Dutch, so I'm blunt, and I'm going to say to you that if for me, as the Vice Chancellor of Humanistic Studies, the University of Humanistic Studies, this is a very outdated kind of discussion, I think, because it is so. Why are you so in the opposition to each other? For instance, Peter, you are talking about truth and finding truth, but you know that truth only exists within a paradigm, and you jump from paradigm to paradigm. So, where's then the truth? And for instance, let me say, give you an explanation. At my university, we are working on research on aging well and how to do that. And there are many people working on this kind of research. There are medical people are trained in medicine. So they're trying to find out how you grow old healthy. And there are socialists working on aging well, and they try to find out what aging means in society in the coming years. And there are people, ethicists, working on aging well, because in the end, we are all growing old and we will need help. So there is conceptual thinking, and philosophers and ethicists are also working on that very grand questions together. And I think that when we want to advance in the future, we'll have to work together a lot more than saying to each other, this is science and this is not science. And I have a question for you, Stephen. Do you call yourself a scientist?
Thank you.
Ah, shall I answer that one first?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
No. No, I don't call myself a scientist.
Is it
but I think
S or the small S?
I think Richard Dawkins would call me a scientist, because we had this conversation, and I explained, you know, like what I think I'm doing, and he says, oh yeah, that's all great, but why call it philosophy? And I said, why am I just a scientist then? His answer was yes, as far as I can remember. I don't really care what you call it, but it seems to me that what I am doing is a perfectly legitimate and worthwhile activity, and it seems to me that it would be highly misleading to call it science, because it is essentially non-empirical, which is the bit that Peter doesn't like about it.
There are a lot of empirical philosophists. Mm.
Okay, Peter?
Well, back to aging. Of course your studies there have to be evidence-based. I don't see that philosophers are going to help you very much in sorting out an understanding of aging. What you've got to do is to be aware of the physical changes that are taking place in minds and bodies. I'll concede that, you see. And act accordingly. You don't need philosophers to help you. They'll just muddy the water.
There was earlier on in the question, there was a comment about truth being relative to paradigms. So I suspect that would have set Peter right off, and me also. but perhaps you should.
That,
yeah.
Okay. Well,
yeah. Maybe we'll come back.
Okay. This gentleman in glasses.
I too worry about what we're worrying about. I think that we tend to be pretty clear about what science is, but perhaps less clear what philosophy is. The characterization that I like the most, is, I think they might be unhappy, is that it's dealing with the problems that nothing else can deal with at the time.
Yes.
Now, if you look at it in that way, I think you can see that Peter Atkins is probably being rather harsh when he says that science has gradually taken over all the areas of philosophy, so it shows that philosophy is a failure. Actually, that shows that philosophy is a success. It wasn't that there were a bunch of scientists who came and elbowed the philosophers out of the way. The people who said they were doing philosophy worked up to the point where you could begin to tackle it in a scientific way. And I suspect you will constantly see that sort of development, where subjects that you cannot deal with, science cannot deal with at any one time, will be able to deal with at a later time. And philosophy will move on to other pastures too.
Well, pastures and maybe. But that is effectively what I was saying, that the progress in science, evidence-based interaction with nature, has gradually removed the need for philosophy. It moved into the domains that were once regarded by philosophy as its own. And it's fine, the fact that that's true also of theology, that modern science has eliminated most of the theology by showing that evidence-based inquiry can explain rather than obfuscate. And I'm sure that Stephen agrees with that.
I'm absolutely with you on the fact that philosophy once used to encompass a great deal more territory. The empirical sciences, of course, all fell under philosophy's umbrella. I also would certainly be sympathetic to the view that just because we can't understand how something could be the case, therefore, well, science will never explain it then, you know. We can't understand how inanimate matter could become animate without sprinkling some supernatural fairy dust on the thing in question. Well, now we know that that's not the case. In fact, scientists can explain how it is that inanimate matter can indeed become animate. So we shouldn't be too pessimistic about what science can establish. On the other hand, it's pretty clear that there are puzzles that are essentially conceptual in nature. And I gave you several examples right at the beginning. They're clearly conceptual puzzles.
They're linguistic.
And it clearly,
they're not conceptual.
Well, then call them linguistic then. If you like, then I'll be a linguistic philosopher. I'm not entirely sure they're entirely linguistic, but certainly in many cases they are linguistic. And in that, in which case, it seems to be that this is, again, very important work. It's worth focusing on those kind of conceptual puzzles, in part because they are very often moral puzzles, and so very often people will walk past these problems without even noticing that there was a problem or a puzzle there. You need a certain amount of kind of conceptual awareness even to spot that there is some kind of difficulty.
Yeah, I think that really the only domain left for philosophy is moral philosophy, really. I think that its current domain of explication of phenomena. I will concede that point.
Okay.
You know, how many is it appropriate to kill, for example, in order to achieve an aim? Mm. Very deep philosophical questions which no computer can yet answer.
Thank you.
Oh, yes.
Next lady here, with the glasses on there.
I just put my hands up and I didn't have quite time to formulate my question because it was late. I just come from a background of science communication, and I have to say I feel a slight empathy with the philosophers. There are two issues in which I feel an empathy. One is in the terms of what you call semantics, where often science in its evolution has appropriated language which is older than itself, and then seeks to define a problem in the way that science identifies the subject, for example, in energy, and then gets into terrible battles with the non-scientific world in debates about how you define energy and concepts like that. So I think a philosophical, somebody who's actually looking at the language that you use in science and how you apply it in the general world, is a valuable contributor to scientific debates, and particularly for the general public. I've forgotten my second point, so I'll sit down.
Energy is the capacity to do work, as simple as that. So ask a scientist what he or she means by energy, and you shall get that answer. I can't think of anything clearer.
Okay, there's blonde guy here with the glasses on.
To me, one of the very interesting things about philosophy, it's sort of meta-thinking, and it's about discovering new ways of thinking. And if I'm not mistaken, science was one of them. Isn't it important to try to discover new ways of thinking, new paradigms that could, for instance, improve science, or maybe even create a better framework for finding truth? I mean, maybe science is the last great way to find truth, or even reason. I think it's important to have an open mind about that. And I also think language, I mean, it's what we think in. So isn't it important to be conscious of that? Wouldn't that improve everything, including science?
Well, of course, science has developed its own private language for making discoveries, which is called mathematics. And mathematics is an extraordinary way of exposing the deep structure of the universe.
I thought maths came first, actually. Is it?
Yeah.
I had maths in ancient Greece, but the scientific method is only 400 or 500 years old.
Let's go to my
dear please.
Yes,
Okay.
My name's Graham Richards. I've got a foot in both camps here. I did philosophy jointly with psychology at Newcastle under Mary Meachley, who I'm sure you have a great deal of time for. I then became a psychologist, written a book on human evolution. So I'm very puzzled, in a bit, to some extent, by Peter's sheer optimism about science. Science over the last 150 years has been utterly devoid of moral compass. It's caused things like eugenics, degenerationism, The majority of scientists are employed in the military or in farmers who, like all drug pushers, are mainly interested in getting more and more people addicted to their products. And I just do not see this optimistic view of science. I love the scientific cosmology. I love discoveries in astronomy and paleontology. But I do think that the strength of philosophy is that it, as you in a sense conceded it finally, is on the moral front. And in terms of concepts, and here, echoing A.C. Grayling, trying not to self-censor, I think Dawkins' use of the concept of selfishness is an utter mess. It's a complete exploitation of everyday concepts of selfishness to try and put forward what is a technical concept. It leads to a kind of crude mind-body dualism in which I am somehow the victim of this other agency. Well, who am I then? It just seems to me that there's a lot of unrealism in an unquestioningly optimistic view of science.
Well,
I'm sorry about that. But
first of all, we have to distinguish science from scientists. And science is amoral, if you like. And scientists may be immoral. But I think it's very important to distinguish the subject itself from the human desires, often despicable, of the practitioners. So don't accuse the subject.
But that means it's about freedom. We're talking about free inquiry. Most scientists are not free inquirers. They're being paid by employers to investigate topics which are of material benefit to the employer.
Yeah,
you're talking about capitalism, not science.
There we are. And as to selfishness, well, I will speak for Richard. I know he's in the audience, but like so many people, you have misinterpreted, overinterpreted the use of that term.
Yes, I agree with that. I'm with Peter on scientists can be immoral and corrupt and so on. And it may be that there will be vested interests that want scientists to draw certain conclusions, but actually if you continue to apply the scientific method, the truth will out eventually, no matter how corrupt the institutions may happen to be. That's your, at least that is your best
that
protection.
That is the
against
extraordinary
it.
Strength of science.
Exactly, so we're on board
the truth
absolutely, out. Yeah.
We have Blaise Bees here.
Well, my definition, or my idea of what a philosopher is, I'm the philosopher Wittgenstein, and he said, a philosopher is not a citizen of any community of ideas. That is what makes him a philosopher. So the idea that somebody can look at the ideas of a community and look from the outside, and where I think that particularly comes to fruition is in the philosophy of science, which I'm surprised hasn't been mentioned before. It seems to me, prior to Popper, people thought it was all just induction. Popper clarified that. Kuhn came along with another idea. Lakatosh modified that. That, to my mind, is quite serious progress about how you would go about the scientific method.
In theory, it is. I'm not sure that practicing scientists think in a Popperish way at all. And certainly the paradigms of science, a Cumian sort of approach, are evolving. And we are seeing that, for example, in string theory, where it may be that evidence will not be forthcoming for a theory which otherwise shows extraordinary power of prediction and providing understanding. And I think we may be moving cautiously into a domain where even Stephen will feel comfortable. That we can note that science has become so mature that it has to accept that even without evidence, evidential observations, it has to accept theories. That may be the case with string theory. Very dangerous world that we're on the brink of.
Now, let's have another question.
Okay, great, okay. Do you want to start at the back? There with your shirt on.
I sympathise a lot with the lady from the Netherlands who said, you know, that scientists and philosophers should be working together. I believe that there are, when you concede that moral philosophy is perhaps a region where philosophers can do good work, you concede the whole argument, because that's where philosophy is doing its best work at the moment. There are ethical questions, particularly around medics and growing old, and how society should address those problems that are deeply philosophical, and how do we actually arrive at the ethical solution to some of these problems. We do need to think very deeply about them and to do the necessary political and social adjustments to address those very enormous and current questions.
I've conceded that point, and I agree entirely with what you're saying.
Yeah.
Sorry, I forgot to say that the attack on Dawkins just actually showed how very misunderstood the argument was on the part of the attacker. I mean, quite frankly, Dawkins wasn't talking about a selfish gene that actually thought it was selfish. He was trying to explain evolution.
He chooses that as the title of the book precisely because those are the associations everybody had.
It's a very useful analogy, and you made that clear. And
you had your say, but I think you misunderstood Dawkins.
Yeah, I think so. Is he here?
Yes.
Is he
coming? Can we have the
I tend to agree generally with Peter, but I've got to admit that there have been some substantial contributions from philosophy to science, particularly, say, in the area of linguistics or cognition, or say, Bertrand Russell's work in logic, which is the foundation of mathematics. So I think that we, on the science side, should be just too critical of the past time.
I'd quite like to talk about the mind-body problem, actually, because I think it's probably, there are these two big problems now, really, left, aren't there? There's where did it all come from, and what the hell is the mind, and how does it relate to the body? And somebody's hand's gone up there straight away. they're sorted. Oh, thank goodness. I think that the mind-body problem is essentially a conceptual problem. I don't see that there's any particular problem in establishing correlations between what's going on in minds and bodies and so on. Similarly with smoke and fire, that doesn't make smoke fire. And in fact, there might be some conceptual reason for insisting that smoke can't possibly be fire. Similarly, some conceptual reason for supposing that, say, minds cannot be bodies. I mean, conceptual work could be done in this area. There's a famous example, Gilbert Ryle, as this very nice example of somebody wandering around the university looking at the colleges and the examinations and schools and so on, and then wandering up to some academic and saying, you know, we saw the Radcliffe camera, we saw the colleges, can you tell us where's the university, right? And that is a classic example of a category mistake. The person thinks that the university is an additional entity in addition to the colleges and the examination schools and so on. And once they've understood what's going on conceptually, they realise they asked a silly question, or the question was perfectly obvious, had a perfectly obvious answer. Now, similarly, it might be, I mean, Ryle's view about the mind was that when you say, well, I can see the person smiling and I can see them working out the calculation and I can see that, you know, that they're really responding very badly when I hit them with a hammer and say, But where's the mind, right? He thought that similarly there was a kind of a category mistake being made there, that minds are some additional entity over and above all of these other things that we might talk about. And if that's true, and if that, it isn't unfortunately, but if that were true, that would be a really neat conceptual solution to the mind-body problem.
But the
now, that's the kind of work that it seems to me philosophers are very, very good at. They're good at spotting those kind of category mistakes. They're good at thinking through the consequences of our positions and discovering unacknowledged consequences. They're good at spotting the kind of conceptual errors that we tend to make otherwise over and over again. And that all seems to me to be very valuable. I gave the example of scientists very often running into serious trouble when it comes to investigating paranormal phenomena and people like Uri Geller. You know, they just don't see what's really going on in front of them. They're missing out on the really crucial things. And it seems to me that that is often the case when scientists turn their hand to what are, in effect, philosophical problems, or certainly scientific problems that have a deep philosophical character to them.
You see, once again, you're exhibiting what I'm complaining about in philosophy. You're inventing a problem and then spending a lifetime trying to solve it. St. Thomas Aquinas did that. And great philosopher he might have been, but complete waste of time. You've just done it, or you collectively, you philosophers have done it. You've invented this concept of mind. And then you get worried about it, and then you don't see how this thing that you've invented relates to the brain. I mean, if you had not invented the concept of mind, and simply
I didn't invent it. I mean, we didn't invent it. They did, right?
I'm using you with a capital Y.
Okay.
If you hadn't invented it, and you had called it brain activity, then everything would have been much clearer. But you've got this kind of mystical thing that you've.
No, but the mind isn't a mystical thing. I mean, that's the thing. It may well not be a mystical thing.
It's brain activity.
Oh, it's brain activity. Well, now we've got an identity theory, and now I'll just run a conceptual obstacle, a conceptual argument that you will not be able to solve,
you
won't be able to deal with.
This thing that you call mind, you think is not necessarily brain activity.
I'm just very baffled about minds. I think they are deeply baffling things. There are lots of conceptual puzzles there, and I can't solve them all. I've seen various attempts to solve them, but I have not yet seen really much progress. I'm not saying that it won't happen. I'm not pessimistic, necessarily, okay? I think that philosophers do make progress. We solved some philosophical puzzles earlier on, you know, the ones involving rivers and so on. I showed you how you can do it. It may be that we can make progress here. Very often in philosophy, it takes a very long time for someone to solve a puzzle, and then suddenly when you've solved it, everyone goes, oh, God. You know, it was that easy, it was that simple. Dealing with quantifiers, for example, Aristotle really struggled with quantifiers, and then Frege, much later on, developed a theory, and once you've seen Frege's theory, you go, oh my God, it's that straightforward, it's that simple. But it took 2,000 years, right, to figure it out, conceptually, how you deal with quantifiers. That kind of work is hard work. It's genuinely worthwhile. The development of that kind of system of logic was hugely important in all sorts of ways. And it just seems to me to be bizarre, really, to just throw it all in the bin and say, oh no, that's just a waste of time. It just seems to me a complete misunderstanding of what philosophy is and what's valuable about it.
Could that lady in the back, please? Yeah, should we have that up? Yeah.
I actually have two questions. The first one is directed at Peter. And it looks, I mean, I started off studying science because I wanted to do theoretical physics. And I realize now that all of the math and theoretical physics is based upon conceptual thinking. And then you use that and you apply it to experimental physics. So I'm wondering whether isn't that just using the philosophy and what Stephen was explaining was conceptual engineering, so the armchair thinking. And then applying that to questions about the world. And then the second question is sort of going on from that and looking at Galileo's thought experiment. I would like to get sort of both of your opinions on Hume's problem of induction and whether you both not feel a bit uneasy about the fact that maybe all of the scientific method and all of the induction and even sometimes deduction that we do in everyday life might actually be based on a logical dilemma, which isn't proven.
So maybe perhaps Stephen can explain the problem of induction better than I can. No, sorry. So,
yeah. Right, the problem of induction, Hume's problem of induction, the original problem, is that scientists engage in reasoning that involves premises and conclusions, and the premises are supposed to support, but not logically entail, deductively entail those conclusions. You know, say swan 1 is white, swan 2 is white, swan 1000 is white, therefore all swans are white, or the next swan will be white, for example. The premises could be true and the conclusion false, but still we suppose that if the premises are true, that strongly supports the conclusion. That's called inductive reasoning. And Hume famously raised this problem about how you justify inductive reasoning. How do you do it? Why do we make those inferences? Because we assume that nature is uniform. Because we assume that the patterns that we see locally will extend over the horizon and will continue on. That's why we think the next swan, the one we haven't seen yet, is going to be white, because all the ones we have seen thus far have been white. But how do you know that nature is uniform? It's not any kind of logical truth. You can't know that just by having to think about it from the comfort of your armchair. But then how do we know that nature is uniform? Because, oh, it's uniform around here, so it's probably uniform everywhere else then. But that would be an inductive argument. You would be using induction to justify induction. And that's circular justification. It's a bit like trusting mystic maker because she says that she's reliable. How much of a justification is that? No justification at all. So similarly, trusting induction because induction works, or induction, you know, has worked around here thus far, so probably it will work tomorrow, then these are inductive arguments and therefore are no good. So you can't justify induction, therefore you have no reason whatsoever to suppose that the sun will rise tomorrow. And that is insane. And anyone that believed that, we would probably consider them to be insane. Yet it seems to be, paradoxically, the conclusion of a sound argument. The predictions of our greatest scientists are no more likely to be true than the predictions of our biggest loonies, frankly. I mean, that, clearly that's not true, but so there's something wrong with the argument. What's wrong with the argument? Over to Peter, the scientist, who will now explain that to us.
There is evidence in support of induction.
Do you see the problem with
yeah,
that?
Exactly. A partial support for induction is that if you...
It's no support at all. Well, it's like trusting Mystic Meg because she says she's reliable. It's no justification whatsoever.
Let me at least finish.
Okay, sorry. I'm getting over it.
A partial support for induction is that if you do experiments in the laboratory, for example, on a pendulum in order to establish the laws of mechanics, and then you extend observations out into the furthest distant part of the universe, you still find that those laws are applicable. So, although that is not complete support for induction, it is at least partial evidential support for induction.
It's not on the face of it, because it's completely circular. Any justification that is circular is no justification whatsoever, and in this case we're using induction to justify induction, and that's no justification at all. Or at least, but now we would need to explain why that's the justification if trusting a second-hand car salesman because he says he's reliable,
yeah.
Right? If that's not okay, why is it okay to trust induction then? Because induction suggests that induction is reliable.
It's like the white swan problem, that, okay, you're going to get a black swan at some point, maybe, to undermine your inductive argument. But in effect, looking at the laws of physics at ever more remote regions of the universe, both in space and in time, is like finding more and more swans that are white and never coming across a black swan. Now, of course, there might be a black swan, I speak allegorically, at the edge of the universe.
Yeah.
But if you really do get substantial confidence in induction.
Not if circular justifications are no justifications at all. You just don't. I mean, what you're now moving to, oh, well, it's possible the sun will not rise tomorrow, and possibly there will be a black swan tomorrow, but it's overwhelmingly unlikely that these things will crop up. No, you have no justification whatsoever for thinking that these things won't crop up, unless you've already explained why we should consider justification to be reliable. And unfortunately, the only justification that we have is the use of inductive reasoning. And a circular justification is a wholly circular justification. That is a very nasty problem, puzzle. I don't know how to solve it, but you're not going to do it by doing science. It's, and yet science relies on our providing a solution to it.
Well, sorry, but if you saw all the swans in the universe and every one of them was white, that would have confirmed your previous argument pointing towards the reliability of induction.
Well, no, because there's the next one that's going to be born. How do you know it's going to pop up? There's always over the horizon. Science is about establishing what's true beyond that which we have observed. And unfortunately, no matter how much you observe, as soon as you move even one step beyond it, you have to rely on inductive reasoning. And at that point, why should we trust inductive reasoning?
Because it works.
And that's a wholly just circular justification. And if we will condemn justifications elsewhere for being wholly circular and say, no, that's no justification at all, and that is the right verdict when it comes to second-hand car salesman and Mystic Meg, then we have to be consistent to say the same about science.
Okay, let's move on from that one. I actually have some questions which were sent in to me by delegates who are not able to attend. And the first one isn't the main difference between science and philosophy what we deem to be acceptable methodology? Is it methodology not a changing component within different philosophical subdisciplines rather than an immutable precondition of all forms of inquiry?
I'm not sure I understand the question.
Basically, until recently, that has been a distinction, that you sit around evidence-free, largely, dreaming up visions of the universe. I go out with my hammer and chisel and take it to the rocks and find the evidence and talk to my colleagues who have also taken out chisels to their rock and they've counted swans too. But my worry, going back to the question earlier on about string theory, sorry, alluding to string theory as well, I mean, it may be that we're shifting into a modern phase, a postmodern phase of science, where we have to accept that we can't do experiments. I mean, to test string theory, you need to build an accelerator, it is said, the size of the solar system. And few governments have got that much cash to spend. I'm not quite sure that's true, but it is pointing a way to a worrying postmodern phase of science. That we will come round and become philosophers.
Heaven forbid.
Let's go to the back of glasses, please.
I have glasses in this room. I just worry a little bit about the dichotomy as if science and philosophy between them covered the whole of rational inquiry. There are people who are historians or textual scholars of various parts, people who would not consider themselves as scientists, and we would not consider them scientists or philosophers if it comes to that. But they're engaged in some kind of rational inquiry, right? It arguably is a sort of empirical inquiry in the case of historians, but we don't consider them scientists in the normal sense. I wonder whether a lot of this discussion is just semantic. Once we admit that scientists have to engage in a lot of conceptual thinking, once we admit that philosophers have to be well informed by empirical knowledge, once we realise there are other people who are engaging in inquiry by studying ancient texts or whatever they're doing, it seems that some of these words are just rather, they're rather arbitrary beyond everyday use for pedagogical purposes, say, dividing up university faculties and departments. Where do we put historians and so on in this discussion?
Well, you can't do history without evidence.
I suppose, Peter would want to say, well, there's the empirical-based inquiry, and then there's the bullshit. and I'll be in
what is
as a mathematician, I want to point out what was already said two times, but it's completely non-empirically. It's completely analytically, so from your point of view, it wouldn't be science, it would be more philosophy. Still, you need to use it every day to do empirical science. And the same goes for logic and theoretical physics, like it was already said.
Well, first of all, you don't need mathematics for all science. You don't need to be a mathematician to do organic chemistry. You don't need really to be a mathematician to be an evolutionary biologist, really. But what mathematics is proving to be is an extraordinary language for the description of nature. And it's a very deep question about why mathematics seems to be so well fitted to being the language of choice for the physical sciences. Very deep question, and I think the resolution of that question will bring us closer to answering not perhaps just one of those deep questions to which Stephen alluded, but maybe even both. In the sense that talking about the origin of the universe out of absolutely nothing will be a mathematical theory. It won't be a word theory. And linking through to the fact that mathematics is this extraordinary construct of the human brain, which is quite remarkable. And to see how those two prongs of understanding sort of penetrate through the fabric of the universe is most interesting.
But you need an axiomatic system, so it's not...
I'm sorry?
You need an axiomatic system, so it's not made out of nothing. So you can't use a mathematical theory for this question, since you need something to start with.
Well, you can certainly generate the integers from the null set.
Not without any axiomatic system. It's impossible.
Yeah.
Okay.
And it's a very interesting question, why is there something rather than nothing? And I mean, I don't pretend to know the answer to the question, but you might make philosophical progress in the following kind of way. You might say, it's a very radical kind of nothing, isn't it? There's when we talk about nothing, very often we talk about, you know, there being nothing in my glass, it's an empty tract of space, or there's nothing happening, there's nothing going on for a particular period of time. But the kind of nothing that we're talking about when we talk about absolute nothing, you know, why is there something other than absolutely nothing whatsoever? We're talking about not just an empty bit of space or something not happening for a period of time. We're talking about the removal of the stage itself. The spatio-temporal stage is absent. And that is a very, very radical kind of nothing. How do you get something out of nothing with a capital N? Now, one way we might approach that question would be a philosophical conceptual way, would be to say, well, what exactly do we mean by nothing here? What does that word mean? Are we perhaps taking a word that has its home within the spatio-temporal setting and then continuing into it to apply it outside that setting in a way that actually doesn't even make sense? Now, possibly that's true, and if that is true, then the question, why is there something rather than nothing with a capital N, is a non-question. We've just solved the puzzle by doing conceptual analysis. And that would be progress, and that would be philosophy.
An alternative approach is to buy my book on the internet.
Which is available in the Blackwell's bookshop.
Which is available in Blackwell's bookshop, which addresses the very problem from a scientific viewpoint that Stephen has just himself addressed.
Thank you.
Thank you. Very simple question. I trained as a scientist many, many years ago. I struggle with the concepts of modern science. Is there a role for the philosopher to explain what we mean by inflation after the Big Bang? What we mean by the Higgs boson? What we mean by string theory? These are things that I have great difficulty understanding. I'm sure a lot of people in the room also do. Can a philosopher help us understand how we create something from nothing? And I tripped up when it came to the square root of minus one.
Yeah.
You know, there's a role for the philosopher there, surely.
Very often the terms get bandied about in a particular discipline without too much thought being put to exactly what they mean. However, I think that actually, in the hard empirical sciences, that doesn't really happen very much. Actually, the scientists tend to be very thoughtful and careful about what they mean. And it seems to me that sometimes they struggle to explain what they mean, but that's in part because these things just are extremely difficult to understand. Philosophers can sometimes be very good at making clear things that are actually really quite difficult. And so maybe a philosopher would be able to help, but I'm not sure it would have to be a philosopher. Just somebody that's good at explaining stuff. Would be good.
Underlying that question, and underlying Stephen's response to it, is that you must clear your mind of the thought that philosophers are going to arrive at the answer as to how something can come from nothing. They will not. All they will go on saying is that it is beyond the grasp of human imagination. Wait for the scientists to get there. The cosmologists will be the people who get there. The mathematicians will be the people who get there. Not the philosophers.
Well, maybe it's like this. Maybe if suppose somebody shows up and they say, I've made an amazing discovery in the jungles of Brazil, a round square. The mathematicians in this university would be very excited about this, or would they? No, not really, no. They would certainly not be ploughing lots of money into a research project to go to Brazil and find out if this object is really there. No, they know from the comfort of their armchairs that there ain't no such object there. It's fairly clear. You can figure that out pretty quickly on your own with your eyes shut. We're not going to waste our time doing science, empirical investigation, to find out whether the thing is there or not. We know it's not just by thinking about it. Now, it may be that similarly, the question, why does the universe exist? Why is there something rather than nothing? Is a similar kind of question. And I provided, about 5 minutes ago, a diagnosis of why, actually, you might not need to do any science in order to answer the question, because the question doesn't need an answer. What you need is therapy, conceptual therapy, so you stop asking stupid questions. Only this time, it's much, much harder to spot exactly what's wrong with the question. It takes a philosopher to figure it out. Certainly you're not going to solve it by doing empirical science. It's essentially a conceptual puzzle.
There is one thing wrong with your question, one word wrong, and I know I'm going to open up myself to despication, if that's not a new word. There is no valid question in the universe that begins with the word why.
There's a whole branch of philosophy of science devoted to
complete waste of time.
It's called scientific. I mean, Hempel's covering the whole model of scientific exploration. No. Go and look it up.
Those questions that we think of as why questions are actually bundles of how questions, which are too tedious to unravel and deconstruct into the component how questions. So it's not why did the universe come into existence, it's how the universe came into existence, things like that.
How and why questions are sometimes the same question, but not always. I mean, if you ask the question, well, why did the rock fall down the ravine, and how did the rock fall down the ravine? These are not the same question. The reason the why it fell down is because there was an earthquake and that got it rolling. As to what, you know, yeah, how it rolled down the ravine, where it went left, and then it bounced off the tree, and it's a different question.
But
do you know what? What you bought into there is the theological distinction between how and why questions that theologians use, ironically, in order to try to immunise what they believe against scientific refutation. This is the distinction. Now, you don't find philosophers of science doing this, to my knowledge. It's theologians that make this distinction. I don't think you should be buying into that
distinction. But you were saying, why?
No, because you don't like why, because you think, that means there's an agent back there that's responsible, and that's really what I'm presupposing, but I'm not, and that's not how scientists
use it. That's why I think that how you should always... everyone who thinks they've got a why question should deconstruct it into a concatenation.
No, you just shouldn't understand why questions in that theologically loaded way. That's what you shouldn't do.
Okay, next gentleman
with the...
No?
Oh,
sorry, I thought you had your hand up. Yeah, sure.
Sorry,
if
I haven't got glasses.
Then I have
glasses.
You
can't go back. Yeah. I just had the feeling that when you answered your question about said something about is there something rather than nothing, that you did the same Peter accused you of earlier, you defined the term nothing, and you explained why it doesn't matter, but you didn't really answer the question at all. You just evaded it somehow by using linguistics.
No, I explained why it was a confused question.
Yes, but the question itself is still relevant.
No, it's
what
not.
Was there,
why
what
is it a meaningless or muddled question?
What was there before the Big Bang, or what was there before anything, or what?
No, you can't ask. Yes, actually, you can't ask that one because there wasn't it before. I mean, that's the people often slip into these unfortunate ways of speaking, don't they? They you know, before the Big Bang, you hear scientists speaking that way, but of course they don't really mean it because there was no before it.
Well, we don't. Yeah, but it's just semantics. I can't utter the question in a way because I can't say a sentence before without using before. So there is something that caused everything. I can't phrase the question because my language lacks the ability to do so.
Okay.
And you just said, okay, you can't answer the question, so it's irrelevant.
Yeah, it's a bit like, it might be like this, it might be like asking, what's north of the North Pole? and to begin with, you think, oh, interesting question. Then the more you think about it, because you know that, you know, what's north of Edinburgh? Well, Iceland. What's north of Iceland? Well, so what's north of the North Pole then? Well, at this point, you've kind of hit the buffers. I mean, that's the end of the line so far as asking what's north of so-and-so. You can't really ask that question at that point because north is kind of a defining point so far as northness is concerned. And so it's a nonsensical question. And once you've realised that, you won't ask the silly question anymore. And it may be that similarly, why is there something rather than nothing with a capital N is similarly just a muddled question. And what you need is linguistic therapy so that you won't go around asking those kind of questions. Well, it depends whether it's science will answer the question if it's a legitimate question. But before we waste our money on going to Brazil and finding the round square or answering this question about why there's something rather than nothing, let's actually figure out whether the question even makes sense.
Well, it does make sense in the sense that suppose there were pieces of matter that so distorted space-time that a circle became a square. Wouldn't that be worth discovering?
Yeah, but that's completely different because we were talking about square circle, things that are both simultaneously both square and circle. Obviously square things become circular all the time. I mean, I could quite easily take this circular thing and tread on it and make it a square thing. But, that's not to say that it would be reasonable to suppose that there might be square circles out there. Obviously there is no such thing, and I know that from the comfort of my armchair. I may not know what is out there, for that we'll need some scientists. But I can be sure there's no square circle out there. I think I can be pretty sure there's no Judeo-Christian God out there, also just from the comfort of my armchair.
I wouldn't be too sure about the
Peter's
square
very
circle.
Pessimistic about that. Have you noticed? Have you noticed how pessimistic he is about what philosophy may or may not achieve? I think he should be more optimistic.
Okay, bringing it back slightly to the theme of Congress, another question I received for both of you is, how do we best utilise our right to freedom of thought in forging a 21st century enlightenment? What would such an enlightenment look like in terms of the place of science and philosophy? And I'll come to you first, Peter.
Oh dear, well I think science is a rather wonderful demonstration of the transcultural, transnational, trans whatever description of the universe that we can all agree on, really. And so it's one of the most unifying of all human activities. And it's more unifying even than that other abstract pastime, music, I think, because you know, if you listen to Japanese music, it's not terribly encouraging to the Western ear. But science is uniform, uniform in acceptance in principle, uniform in language, and as I say, transcultural and trans everything. It is the most unifying language we have, and one needs to propagate it.
I've slightly forgotten the question, but I'll have to...
How do we best utilise our right to freedom of thought in forging a 21st century enlightenment?
Well, I'm not entirely sure I'm answering the question, but what I'm really concerned about is that young people, you know, in schools, are encouraged to think and question, apply their intelligence to the big questions. There's plenty of evidence that, you know, if you run P4C or philosophy for children programs in the classroom, that the kids become, I mean, measurably more intelligent, but the ethos of the school improves. You often find there's less bullying. You're setting up a kind of a community that is curious, that is engaged, that is morally engaged, that's going to be interested in science, in doing science,
and philosophy
too, moral questions. I mean, I think that's the most important thing. And unfortunately, I think it was just today or yesterday, the government has decided that toddlers are vulnerable to extremism and something has to be done. And so they're going to be taking action in our classrooms to make sure that toddlers are... we all know what that action is going to be, isn't it? Let's tell them all about British values and make sure that they learn the British values before some, you know, religious nutcase comes along and gives them some other values. Instead, let's get our indoctrination in first before the other indoctrinators come along. Now, and that is the worst possible thing that we could do. We should be getting them to do philosophy, not spoon feeding them, you know, our own particular ideology. I will make a case for freedom of speech to kids, but I don't want them to accept it on the grounds that I said so.
Okay. Mike. Okay. That Stephen's just mentioned, because it was actually one of the successes of the BHA, and it actually relates to a number of nurseries receiving state funding who were run by creationist or extremist groups. So they were groups who were not allowed to have state-funded primary or secondary schools, but they somehow managed to slip through the net and open nurseries instead. So hopefully that type of indoctrination will end. I'm going to take one final question from this lady here with the glasses on.
Thank you. I think Pavan and Stephen, you may have actually begun to address what I was about to bring up, but I'd really like to see science and philosophy come together to address the dangerous things like creationism. Because although this is a great BHA success, we do have a new Christian education minister in who talks about being Christian and voted against gay marriage in this country. So I'd actually like to see, rather than a dichotomy, science and philosophy really propel their way into education in the way that you were talking about. How can you work together?
Obviously I'd be in favour of that. I mean, Peter, I can't speak for Peter, but I would certainly... So it's certainly true, for example, if you get engaged in a debate with a creationist, if there are any kind of self-respecting creationists, they have already sucked up a lot of moves and arguments that will make it very, very difficult for you to respond by just trotting out evidence. Have you noticed, you know, the layers in the, you know, the sedimentary layers and the fact that the fossils are arranged there in a way that surely strongly supports the theory of evolution and completely contradicts the biblical theory, for example. They're ready for that. They've got a million explanations ready for you, and that's the stuff that they're peddling in the classroom. It seems to me that what you need to combat that is not so much the science, although you do need that. You also need an understanding of how to think straight. And that, you know, on what actually is good science rather than what it is that the creationists are doing. And that we don't teach. Critical thinking and understanding of how science really works rather than the way in which the creationists pretended it works. It seems to me that would be a really very important thing.
And you shouldn't go away from our conflict here this afternoon. This is for an adult audience. Which knows what we're really talking about and knows the way that we really think. What we are showing, I think, is that you can have conflicting views in a civilized way, and I think that's very important as well. It's like, you know, playing rugby. You've got conflicting teams, but you still shake hands at the end of the match if you've got any left. I think showing the delight of inquiry is, however that inquiry takes place, be it in literature, be it in history, be it in philosophy, be it in what we call science, then I think that's a wonderful thing to transmit to people.
find it genuinely too terrifying to actually come to a conclusion at the end of this session. So what I hope that you will all do is, I think, maybe talk to the person behind you when you leave and continue discussions as to which side of the fence that you sit on. But I hope you will join me in thanking our two excellent speakers today. It's the easiest session I've ever chaired in my life. I don't really need to be here. So please join me in thanking Stephen Law and Peter Atkins.